In the last class, we had looked at the cycle analysis for a ramjet, and we had started the cycle analysis for a turbojet. Let's continue the cycle analysis for the turbojet. If you look at the TS diagram, firstly, let's assume that all processes are 100% efficient. That is, we'll assume an ideal cycle initially, and we also started something wherein the flow is optimally expanded in the nozzle. These were the two things that we are going to look at. If we take an ideal cycle, then there is compression in the intake itself, so I will call 0 to 2, and then through the compressor then you have heat addition, then you have expansion through the turbine. Then you have expansion again through the nozzle. Okay, this is the TS diagram we have. Okay. Now we had derived certain things in the last class. We had derived that tau b is nothing but theta b by tau c theta naught. And we had got this expression for F by m dot a naught . This was the expression that we had. Okay. Now let's try and find out how to get these ratios. Just like the previous time wherein we had done this cascading in ramjets, let's do the cascading and find out how we get these temperatures. Now to get T7 by T naught, again you cascade T7 by T7 into TT7 by TT6, TT6 by TT5, TT5 by TT4, TT4 by TT3, TT3 by again, the subscript T here indicates stagnation conditions, and if you take a look at this, all these cancels out and you get T7 by T naught. Okay. So we also know that the last term is nothing but theta naught from our previous class. So we have, this is nothing but a ratio of stagnation to static, so we can express this in terms of Mach number as 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m7 square. Okay. Now what is TT7 by TT6? this is flow through the nozzle. Again, if the efficiencies are 1, the stagnation temperature ratio will be the same. So this is 1, and TT6 by TT5, this is flow through the afterburner. Anyway, we are not considering in this analysis, this analysis is without the afterburner. So this will again be 1, and TT5 by TT4 is flow through the turbine. Now flow through the turbine, because it is again an isentropic process, this ratio will also be, what will that ratio be? TT5 by TT4, 1. You have forgotten something, we derived in the last class that this is tau T. And TT4 by TT3 is processed through the combustor, so I will call it tau B into TT3 by TT2 is flow through the compressor. Again, this is tau C into again you get the diffuser, this ratio, because the flow is isentropic, is 1, and into theta naught. Okay, so we know that tau B is this. If we substitute it there, we will get T7 by T0 is equal to tau T into tau B is theta B by tau C theta naught into tau C theta naught. This is the ratio that we have. This tau C theta naught and this tau C theta naught cancels off, and we get theta B tau T divided by 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m7 square. Okay, now similarly we will do for the pressures. P7 by P0 is equal to, now we assume all efficiencies to be 1, so the first one, this would be, if you cascade it, it will be P7 by PT7 into PT7 by PT6 PT6 by PT5. This is the cascading, and if we plug in the values, then this is the ratio of static to stagnation condition. So you get 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m7 square to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. Then this is flow through nozzle, so you get, for all efficiencies being 1, you get 1. Then you have flow through afterburner, this is again 1. What is this? Flow through turbine, you get pi T. Okay, pressure ratio across turbine, and what happens in an ideal cycle to the pressure ratio across the combustor? For an ideal cycle, the pressure ratio across the combustor, it will be isobaric process. So the pressure is the same. So this ratio would be 1, and PT3 by PT2, this is again pi c ratio, pressure ratio across the compressor, and PT2 by PT0 is flow through diffuser. For an ideal process, this is 1, and lastly, this is nothing but θ0 to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. Okay, fine. Now, I can change this to tau t, and we'll get a new ratio. So I'll do that. I'll get tau t, tau c, θ0 divided by 1 plus okay. This is the ratio that we get, and if you remember, we have taken the case where the flow is optimally expanded through the nozzle. So what is P7 by P0? 1. So we can rewrite this as this ratio as 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 M7 square must be equal to tau t tau c θ0. Right. I can take out the powers without any problem, and therefore I can write it like this. Now remember, in this expression for T7 by T0, in the denominator I have 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 M7 square, which is what I have got there. So if I plug in this value, I will get T7 by T0 is equal to theta b tau t divided by tau t tau c θ0. So I will get this is the temperature ratio. Now to find the Mach number ratio, we will have to take this expression and derive the ratio for Mach numbers. So we know that 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 M7 square is equal to tau t tau c θ0, and we also know 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 M0 square is equal to θ0. So from these two expressions, I can write M7 is equal to tau c tau t θ0 minus 1 okay, and similarly M0, we had done this earlier, is equal to and the ratio M7 by M0 will then become So this is the ratio of Mach numbers, and that is the ratio of temperatures that we were looking for. We got those two, and if we plug them into the expression for thrust F by m dot a naught, okay, that is what we were looking for. So F by m dot a naught is equal to what we had got was m naught into T7 by T naught into M7 by m naught minus 1. And if we substitute the ratios for T7 by T naught and M7 by M naught, we will get this is the expression for non-dimensional thrust that we were looking for. Now, is this expression complete? Is there something that is still missing? See, here you have got tau c and tau t, right? But we know that compressor and turbine power balance must be there. So they cannot be independent of each other, they must be related to each other, and therefore you can write one expression for connecting these, right. So there is a relationship for connecting tau c and tau t, that is through the compressor turbine power balance, okay. Now if we do the compressor turbine power balance, we will get this ratio connecting tau c to tau t. Now we know that flow through compressor is m dot a Cp TT3 minus TT2. This must be equal to m dot a into 1 plus f TT4 minus TT5. Now there are two things that we are going to make an assumption on. If you take a look at this, this is primarily air getting compressed in the compressor, whereas for the flow through the turbine you have product gases. If you remember earlier when we said gamma and R are the same for both air and exhaust gases, right. If gamma and R are the same for both air and exhaust gases, then Cp, what should happen to Cp? Cp should also be the same for both of them. So assuming Cp to be constant, and also we will make another assumption that we have been doing all along, that the fuel air ratio F is very much less than 1 when for a turbojet, because typically this will be of the order of 0.02 to 0.04. So even if you neglect it, you are going to make a 2 or 4% error, okay. So with these two assumptions, this will simplify to TT3 minus TT2 must be equal to TT4 minus TT5. So what we do from here is, we know by cascading what the ratios are. So we just have to divide both sides by T naught. Let's divide both sides by T naught. Now what is TT3 by T naught? Again, if we cascade, I will get TT3 by TT2 into TT2 by TT naught into TT naught by T naught. What is TT3 by TT2? This is flow through compressor, so this will be tau c, and this ratio is 1 across the diffuser. So, and this is theta naught, right? TT naught by T naught is theta naught, and this would be TT2 by TT naught into TT naught by T naught. This again is TT2 by TT naught is 1, and this would be theta naught, fine. And what is T4 by T naught? This is theta b, this is from our definition, and TT5 by TT naught, I can write it as TT5 by TT4 into TT4 by T naught. What is this? TT5 by TT4 is tau t. This is tau t into theta b, okay. So I end up getting, if I take out theta naught as common, theta naught into tau c minus 1 must be equal to theta b into 1 minus tau t. So therefore I can write the expression for tau t as I can write tau t as equal to okay. So this is the expression for tau t. Now if I plug in this expression for tau t in this expression for f by m dot a naught, that is the non-dimensional thrust. Before we do that, what we see here is we need this ratio. All the tau t and tau c terms are only in this ratio. So let's look at this first term in the under the square root sign, and let's try to simplify that. So tau c theta b theta naught, right, divided by tau c theta naught minus I can write the numerator combining these terms. These are the terms containing tau c and tau t. So if I combine these terms and rewrite it, I will get it like this, okay, which is I can simplify this further and write it as tau c theta naught cancels off here. I will get theta b tau t minus theta b by tau c theta naught. And now if I substitute for tau t in this expression, okay, I will get this as equal to theta b minus theta naught tau c So that is now if I plug back this expression into that and rewrite my expression, I will get the non-dimensional thrust as f by m dot a naught must be equal to okay, this is the final expression for the non-dimensional thrust.
This means only theta naught, tau c and theta b are the controlling parameters.
Yes.
Tau t won't affect.
See, tau t and tau c are connected, no? Tau theta b is a controlling factor, is okay with you because it's a turbine inlet temperature. So that is fine with you. What you are looking for is why is it that tau t has gone out. See, tau t had to go out because the compressor and turbine, there is a power balance between them, and we have assumed the processes to be 100% efficient. So the compressor power must be equal to the turbine power. So when you do that, you can eliminate tau t, and that is what we have done here. So it will be only dependent on tau c, theta naught and theta b. Now we have done all these calculations, right. What we need to do is cross check whether what we have got is correct. How do we do that? How do we cross check what you got is correct or not?
Put in some values.
That still does not tell us anything. See, what do we know? We will always assume previous class is true, right, or previous class is correct. So, we know the results for ramjet, right. What is the result for ramjet? The result for ramjet was f by m dot a naught is equal to m naught theta b by theta naught minus 1 for eta is equal to 1. This is for this was the result that we had for ramjet. Now, what is the difference between a ramjet and a turbojet? That you have a compressor, right, compressor and therefore a turbine. So, what happens if you put tau c to be equal to 1? Compressor pressure ratio or pi c is 1 or tau c is 1, compressor turbine temperature ratio is 1 or compressor pressure ratio is 1, that is what is a ramjet, right. So, if you put tau c is equal to 1 here, what happens? Theta naught cancels off and you get tau c, this is theta b by theta naught, right. So, let us do that. Turbojet becomes a ramjet when tau c is equal to 1. So, when we substitute tau c is equal to 1 in the expression for ramjet turbojet, you get theta b minus theta naught into 1 plus theta naught minus theta b by theta naught tau c is again 1. Okay. Now it is obvious that you can cancel out this and you get, you can take out theta b common. So, you get m naught and if you take out theta b as common, what you get is 1 minus 1 by theta naught This is anyway the same as you can take 1 by theta naught out, you will again get so I get which is the same as ramjet. So in that sense it is consistent, okay. What we have derived is consistent with, when we put tau c is equal to 1, we get the ramjet result, okay. Now there is another thing that we need to look at. What is that? We know that turbojets have a static thrust, right. Turbojets do produce a static thrust. Now we need to find out whether the expressions that we have derived do show that. Now in this expression here, what happens, what is the condition for static thrust? If you put m naught is equal to 0, then you get 0, no? So suddenly we have done all this extravagant calculations and suddenly found out that we are on the wrong side. Our equations do not bring out that fact that it still can produce, you know, static thrust. Looks like it produces zero thrust, or is there a catch to it? Let us see. See, we know that what is theta naught? 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m naught square, okay. So if you have m naught and theta naught minus 1. So m naught by under root theta naught minus 1 is equal to, what do you get here? Under root, right. So we can use that here and rewrite the expression. Let us do that. So I get is this correct? Right, we have substituted for this in the earlier equation, and now using this, if you put here m naught equal to 0, this goes to 0. So the expression for static thrust would be static thrust of a turbojet so you get so this is a non-zero quantity, so therefore we can safely say that whatever we have derived is correct and it produces non-zero static thrust, okay. Even when m naught is equal to 0, what happens when m naught is equal to 0? What happens to theta naught? Theta naught sorry, when m naught is equal to 0, it means that theta naught should be 1. So you substitute it here, again you can rewrite this expression. Theta naught so this can not go to 0, and therefore we have a positive static thrust. Okay.
So when aircraft is stationary, like turbulent engine is stationary.
Yes.
It's the static. Okay. But when at the static thrust itself, there is some air moving in the compressor itself.
Okay.
Some air got sucked in the compressor. So it got some velocity.
Yes.
So is it m not really 0 or?
Okay. What is the takeoff velocity of an aircraft?
240 kilometers per second.
Okay, let's do that. See, so you have takeoff velocity around 250 kilometers per hour. What is the speed of sound at that condition? Meters per second. So you convert it into kilometers per second, kilometers per hour. So I'll assume it to be fine around 1200 kilometers per hour. So you calculate the Mach number based on this, what will it be? 0.2. So what is the sacrosanct about 0.3 Mach number, which we say is the regime where we differentiate that the flow is incompressible and then the flow becomes compressible. What is this limit of 0.3?
So density variation is less than 5%.
So if you look at this number here, Mach number is 0.21. So if we do 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2, this is m naught square, this is nothing but theta naught. How different will it be from 1? This will be anyway close to 1, no? So even while the aircraft is taking off with very high velocities of around 240, 250 kilometers per hour, the Mach number is around 0.2 to 0.3, which means that it's still theta naught is still around 1. Okay. So therefore this is consistent. What we have done here is consistent, fine. Okay. Now let's look at what happens to the other quantity of interest to us, that is ISP. Okay. In the previous class, when we were looking at ramjet, we had already done this exercise, and we noted that ISP by A naught, which is the speed of sound, we can write this as 1 by f into f by m dot a e naught, right. And we said that we put in a lot of effort to find out this expression, so it is meaningful to use this to get the ISP. So we know this part and we need to evaluate what is this quantity, right. So let us do that. We can evaluate this by again looking at the power balance in the combustor. From energy balance across combustor, I can write m dot f q is equal to m dot a into 1 plus f and what we will again do is we are trying to find an expression for f. We will say that f here in comparison to 1 is small, so therefore we will neglect that. We can do that even while trying to derive this expression for f. So f is nothing but m dot f by m dot a. So using this, so I can rewrite my expression as one by f must be equal to q by Cp. I'll take out T naught as common, then I'll be left with TT4 by T naught. Okay, what is TT4 by T naught? This is theta b what is this TT3 by TT2 into TT2 by TT naught T naught, this is theta naught, this is 1, this is tau c. So you get 1 by f is equal to q by Cp T naught into theta b minus tau c theta naught. Okay. So this is the expression into, now we have got 1 by f there, so I can write the complete expression for ISP by A naught as equal to theta naught tau c plus theta naught so this is the expression that we have for ISP by A naught. We will stop here and we will continue in the next class. Thank you.